So
shall we start with the what the fuck movie did we make?
What are we doing here?
What the fuck?
It's not a very what the fuck movie. It's a very sweet kind of family movie. Yeah. Really get down to it.
Sure, yeah, it is.
Was that your intention, or is that the mainstream of Indian cinema, or what was your thinking on that?
No, I mean, it's definitely not the mainstream of Indian cinema. It's not. We are way off the. We are not even a tributary of the mainstream of Indian cinema. But I mean, the intention was. It's a movie about loneliness to me. But the way, I mean, of course, we need butts on seats, and you know, and it's also a love story. So that becomes sort of the primary way to talk about it. You know, mm-hmm. It's a love story between two lonely people.
Yeah, for me, primarily it was love story. But if it was only for about loneliness, then you know it would have been difficult for me. Well, yeah, exactly.
So, how did the two of you meet?
We met via the producers. Actually, when I finished the first draft of the script that worked, I really wanted to have fun in it. So, approached him via the producers, and he read the script, and then we met a couple of times.
I think I was shooting Life of Pi, and I got the mail from Lydia, and she told me about this idea, and I loved the idea, and I immediately told her, has he made any other films? She said, he's made some shorts. Mm-hmm. So I asked her if I could watch them. So they sent two of his shorts on some website, Vimeo or something, you know, and I couldn't download properly. You know, I could see only one. Then later you sent me one more film which was in Israel.
Yeah.
That was fantastic, you know. It was just about capturing the actor and being with that, being with the actor and see what comes out. That was very, very haunting.
And that's a lot of this movie, your work in this movie, a lot of it's not spoken.
Yeah.
You spend a lot of time staring and thinking and feeling on camera.
That's the reason, you know, I love cinema rather than TV. In TV, you know, I've worked in TV for 10 years, and I was sick and tired of it, saying everything, expressing everything verbally. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's like a change for me, you know, when you don't need to say things, but you can express things. That's a delight, you know, as an actor.
So you guys talked after that, after your Vimeo exchange?
Yeah, we met a couple of times actually, and I was very pleasantly taken aback because Irfan had invested so much time already in the script. We tapped through the script for hours. I went to his place once, and it was supposed to be a 1 hour meeting, but it turned into a 5 hour long meeting, and we literally tapped through the script. We did that a couple of times before the shoot actually. We met several times, and he would have read the script again, and he would have notes on each page, and I would go back home and rewrite based on that. So, you know, as he was trying to find his way into it, I was trying to get it closer to him. And then, you know, by the time we shot, I think we met somewhere in the middle.
So what were you looking for?
See, I'm as a kid, when I used to watch films, you know, I was really drawn into these love stories. Love story which doesn't happen in life, which, you know, cinema gives you, and that emotion stays with you, and you can't excise that emotion, you can't live that emotion in life. So sometimes what happens, you know, you want to do a story and you want to deal with that love, you want to live that love, the emotion of, you know, that love, emotion of that love through these stories. So for me, primarily it was a fantastic haunting love story, so I just wanted to be, you know, live it.
So was it your guy who you were trying to work with together to try to find a more specific character, or were you?
I was trying to just get into the emotion what he created. Mm-hmm. The voiceovers, you know, the longing between each other, you know, and that was unsaid. And what I liked about the film, that there are things which are not understated, which are not underlined, and those are the things which are much more powerful, and they are like, you know, they're very powerful, and that's what I like. Sometimes, you know, every character, you don't have a formula how to get inside the emotional construction of the character, so you have to find new ways. So I was just wondering how will the story start speaking to me, speaking in the sense emotionally, it was already speaking, but you know, as an actor, it should start vibrating in your body and in your mind, and then you know it's you know that's what you're looking for, looking as an actor. So it was his voiceover, the last voiceover. At night, I was reading one night. I was reading around 2 o'clock, and suddenly it started ringing inside me. And I kept recording it again and again to get the real emotion what he has created. And I almost recorded it for 12, 13 times, and I couldn't get the right one. But I could feel that what it is. There's nothing which is said, but there's so much of emotion which is just, you know, oozing out of those words. And they are very simple words. And it's not deliberately, you know, emotional, but there's something which just comes out from it. So that was my way to enter, you know, it just led me to the part.
And it's amazing, you know, how much the writing process is like the acting process. Because when I was on set and I was directing the film, I was trying to leave the, obviously, the writer behind. And both Irfan and Nimrat, and they really fought for the material. Many times I would say, you know, let's try to read between the lines, let's try to go deeper, let's try to do something else. And they would come back and, you know, tell me, no, this is the material. And you know, they really fought for the material. But that really taught me a lot also, because it's hard when you're on a set as director, trying to get back to what you felt when you were writing it, you know. Because what you felt then was very palpable and very, very strong, and you know, but you can't get back to that as a director on set, because you know you're dealing with other things, and then you just have to trust the instincts of your actors, you know, and they had found their way into it. So each time they would fight for the material, and they would tell me, you know, this is what this is. I would be like, yeah, absolutely, because I am not capable at this moment to get to where I was when I was writing it, and they had found their way into it. So.
So I believe what you have created on the paper must remain on the paper. You know, I think it's to recreate it with the real location, real actor. It has to change.
Yeah,
it has to, you know, take a new shape. I believe, but there must be some director who design everything properly and they recreate. Mm. There are, you know, there are directors. I have worked with few of them, and you know, they
put little strings on your shoulders, and they move around.
No, they sometimes they tell you that on this word you just turn on this word and then leave and then go, and I respect them, because they have, there is a kind of, you know, this sometimes it's a need of that story and that scene, you know, sometimes, and you have to, you know, trust them.
So does working with different directors, is each one a different kind of adventure for you as an actor? I mean, is adjusting to those peculiarities part of what's interesting to you about the experience, or do you have a preference to what kind of movies you prefer doing, or kind of directing you like?
If you trust a director, then you know it's an adventure. But definitely, you always relate to more to a system where they let you be what you know, let you explore the moment. I feel very restricted if I'm told what to do. You know, I just need to feel that I should be let loose, and you know, let me just show me, nudge me if you want to, show me the field and let loose, let me run, let me just, you know, just gallop. And that's the kick you get as an actor. That's what you. That's why it's such a special job to do, that you get into that moment, and that moment suddenly takes you somewhere else, and you haven't planned that moment, and that's the surprise. You know, you are looking that charges your batteries. You know.
And the story we're trying to say, tell. I realized before I when we started shooting, it just struck me on day 3 or day 4 that there's really two stories going on here. This is a nice candid moment, isn't it?
Microphones in many different places.
To press it.
Press it down.
Yeah.
No, good.
Yeah,
great.
And I realized that the story we were trying to tell was operating at many different levels, but it just dawned on me once that there's a story that we are trying to tell, you know, which is on the page, but there's a story that's going on in both his mind and Nimrat's mind, you know, this
Because it's like when you meet a stranger, say on the internet, mm-hmm. and you have this fantasy with them, and so there's this other palpable thing that's going on inside them, and how do we bring that out? And for that, I think the what Irfan is talking about, the letting loose and letting them imagine, letting them play inside their heads, that was important. And I think that comes through. That it comes through that there's something that is going on inside them, which is you know, a different sort of fantasy.
Well, particularly in that scene where they're both in the restaurant, it's kind of a moment where you think of all those things that people, even blind dating, but certainly on the internet these days, that people kind of their idea of who they're talking to and what they're doing, and lingering in that moment, and the fear and the excitement is fascinating to watch.
Sure.
So was it fun to poke him? Did you give him a nudge now and again, or did you guys, were you ready to go when you get on set and less nudging?
No, I mean, we were talking a lot.
Yeah, we were talking a lot.
We were talking a lot.
Always.
Before
every scene. Actually, he was talking a lot. Sometimes I used to say, okay, we have now there, but still he will come, you know, he will discuss, and I'll feel like, no, we don't need to talk now. I couldn't say that, you know.
There were some times when there's a lot of solitary moments that he has in the film. And sometimes I realized I just had to tell him, you know, just stand here and smoke. And, but you know, I couldn't get myself to do that. I was like, you know, I can't tell, you know, he's not a marionette. So I'd be like, you know, go deep into the subtext. And then he'd tell me, should I just stand and smoke? Yeah, it's exactly what you need to do.
And did you spend as much time or a similar kind of time with your lead actress? Was that?
Yeah. It was very different, actually, the process, because there was these two stories. And this is Nimrod's first film, and she comes from the theater. I saw her in a play, actually. I saw her in Baghdad Wedding, the Bombay edition of that. And we spent a lot of time looking for the right person. And she just perfectly fit the bill, and she was willing to invest the time in the role and really inhabit that apartment. Mm-hmm. Because her whole story is in that apartment. So she was involved in the production design. She was talking to the production designer every other day. She went and shopped for that place. She really made it her own. Mm-hmm. She also cooked in that kitchen, so it doesn't look like, you know, when we are shooting, that she's just visiting. So she knew where everything was. And so before we actually shot many of those cooking sequences, she knew where the spices were kept, where the ingredients were kept. So we had her tell the DOP and me where she's going to grab what from. So, you know, the whole sort of construction of the scene was a lot guided with her already having cooked in that kitchen. So it was a very different process. It was very, we spent 3 or 4 months together meeting in that apartment. Also, there was a little girl involved. So when you're working with kids, I think it's important to rehearse everything. We rehearsed every scene at least 1 or 2 times before, but for this story, for Irfan's story, we didn't really do any rehearsals. We just spoke a lot, and you know, on set we improvised every now and then, especially the scenes between him and Nawaz, because Nawaz's character sort of shoots off the mouth, and there's this, you know, banter, though most of the time it's one-sided banter, but it needed to feel very organic. So there we just sort of went with the flow a lot. The three of us would get together, discuss, and just do it.
Sometimes aversions to rehearsals, you know, because I have been trained in theater, and what used to happen sometimes in theater, that you know, the director used to tell you, go here, say this, go there, say this, do this, and then I used to feel mechanical, and I used to do rehearsal every day, and you know, feel really sorry about myself that nothing is happening and I'm doing everything. So I have a phobia of that being mechanical, you know.
So you've overcome it?
So I try to make things as surprising for myself as possible. So there are scenes which needs rehearsal, but not always. Now when an actor, if you know the actor, that you know he is not going to get tied up into a kind of design, then you like to rehearse. If you know that the actor is going to follow the blue map, or you know, kind of, you know, then you tend not to rehearse. You know, then you don't want, you know, you need surprise from the other actor as well. So I tend sometimes not to rehearse, you know. If it's there, you are there, you know.
So did you have any days, actual days on set with your leading actress, or did...
Just one day. Because, you know, they were so generous, both of them. Even though they didn't have to be there together in that scene, right. but they were there together. I mean, she was sitting on the table, Irfan was on the other table, and that was a really good day for me. You know, that day I felt like we are really creating something. You know, it was a good day. It was actually the first great shooting day we had. Yeah.
How far was that?
Day three, I think.
Oh,
day
good.
Three.
Not too far.
Yeah.
I think this film was not so exciting. The shooting process was not so exciting because you never know what's happening on the other side.
Mm-hmm.
So he was shooting my portion simultaneously. So I was being with myself. Most of the time, my staff, who's, you know, in India, you have staff like, mm-hmm. you know, your makeup man, your boy, and things like that, your paraphernalia. They always have this idea about the story, what is the story, and they have a kind of opinion about that. But this is the only film, they didn't have a clue what this film was all about.
That's interesting.
I told them you have to see it on the screen, you know.
So you didn't tell them, you just let them hang?
I said because I can't explain them, they have to see it, that there's something is, you know, it's the story is going here and there, you know, it's not just my portions.
So was there another writing of it in post, or did you pretty much, I mean, we talked about respecting the screenplay, the actor is kind of saving it for you. On set, was there much change in post?
A little bit, yeah. There was a little bit because, you know, what I was, I didn't think I was done with the writing.
Mm-hmm.
Because I always, even when I was shooting it, and we were always discussing this, because I had written it and I'm a man, and you know, it was, the story was weighed towards a lot in the script, towards Sajan's character. Mm-hmm. And we were always trying to figure out ways how to bring Ila forward. The last voiceover did not exist in the script, mm-hmm. the very last voiceover, which is sort of her defining, you know, voiceover, mm-hmm. that's sort of the end of her journey, when she's found a sense of self. I wrote that in the post. I wrote that during the edit, and that just came to me from we had shot her standing at the window. So there's a medium shot of hers where we end the movie.
Mm-hmm.
So that just sort of came to me from sort of the emotion of that shot, that she has really, you know, come onto her own and found a sense of self, and hopefully he gets there or doesn't.
Right.
But that last voiceover was sort of the big piece of writing I did in post.
Because this is the kind of movie where you really could make a lot of changes, because so much of it is voiceover, reading the letters and everything.
Yeah. But you know, those voiceovers, when we were shooting the movie, I was really thinking a lot about how to make them visual. Because of course we have the canvas of Bombay, we mm-hmm. have these amazing actors. So the way we shot it, the whole thrust was to make these voiceovers visual. And once you do that, then you don't have a lot of flexibility to change the voiceover, because
right.
you know, you've shot it and you've made it, designed
mm-hmm.
sort of your shots based on the voiceovers. So I was always very protective of these voiceovers, because they're really the soul of the story. You know, they're the real communication in words that's happening. They're sort of the spine of the whole story. So I didn't really change any voiceovers in the edit. Maybe we removed a line or two here and there. But the adding of the last voiceover was the only real change in, you know, the voiceovers.
Did you do the readings of the letters while you were shooting, or did you do
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. There was I was reading them for Nimrat on set, and then of course for Irfan, it would have not been a good experience if, you know, I was reading them. We had the first AD who's a girl read them.
But you know, it took time for the voiceover to get its voice, because it's the way it's written is so simple that you really need a very strange, you know, very relaxed, or I don't know what. It took time, because once I recorded the voiceover, I was not happy, and you know, he came again, and you know, it wasn't working for me. Also, maybe it's not working for him. They came again to India. And then we did it. Then I found the real, you know, connect to it.
Yeah, I think it helped a lot once we had edited it. Once we had sort of the sequence on screen, and then to watch that and absorb that and assimilate that, and then record it again. I think that helped.
So reading to that was part of the trick.
Definitely, yeah.
And so what audience were you expecting for this movie when you started?
Just my
in
mom.
India?
Well, not in India, apparently. Yeah. Not
but,
a mainstream
but you
Indian
know,
movie.
I think we're getting a good release in India. We're releasing in India in 3 weeks. We're releasing on 500 screens. So.
But I mean, were you thinking this was a commercial movie? Were you thinking this was a, you know, going to fit a certain genre? How did you foresee its future?
You know, it's pretty cross-genre. I think the film, you know, it's a love story, it's a drama, it's a comedy. But I always thought that it's something that can speak to a wider sort of world audience. So the way we put the movie together, even the producers that I seeked out are pretty global and, you know, have a track record in, you know, producing world cinema. Mm-hmm. And they were great sounding boards during the editing process as well. So we had a German producer, French producer, an American executive producer, and also an Indian producer. So it's sort of a global project. We also had creative elements from everywhere. The composer is German. The DOP and editor are American. A sound designer, great sound designer from Germany. So it was pretty sort of global project. So I mean, this is the ideal scenario. The film going to Cannes and Telluride in Toronto, but I mean, obviously you can't anticipate these things. But no, we weren't expecting so much love. I certainly wasn't. I knew it would be liked when I finished it. I thought, you know, this is going to be liked, but it's been a little bit overwhelming.
Well, that was really the follow-up question is, what was, did you know, was there a point where you knew kind of audiences were reacting in the way you were hoping they would react?
Was there a point for you when you felt?
No, when I read the script, I knew that, you know, it's immediately connecting to my, you know, my emotions, and I knew that's the USP of the film, and it's like, That's the reason why in Cannes the kind of reaction we got from the buyers of the film, everybody wanted to buy it because it can fit anywhere. It has a universal emotion, and so it's talking to everybody, speaking to everybody. And the interesting thing about this film is that in India, the film scenario is changing every week. It's changing very rapidly, and people are eager to watch something original from India. And there's a new audience, whole new audience, and there's a whole new generation of filmmakers. So they are desperately waiting for something to come out from India and they could connect. And I think this is the first time what this film is doing to Indian market. I've been asking and requesting that, you know, producers to do this kind of collaboration where we get technicians from all around the world and we find a universal language for a film, and that's what this film did, and it will become a kind of example for the other people to follow.
I hope so, but you know, I think it's been interesting, like the whole stories that reflect the Indian condition. I didn't think of this as that. I just was, you know, trying to write what I could. But it's been a real education that there is a real hunger, I think, for stories outside of India, that really reflect the Indian condition, because we're always trying to be somebody else. You know, we're always trying to be American or Tarantino-esque. And I think maybe I really felt this at Telluride actually last week, because I had never, I saw the film at Cannes, we saw it together. And I had never been in a screening where people were so with the movie. As they were, you know, out there, they were laughing with it, crying with it, and they were really with it, and it was a real sort of education to me, and it's a story that's set in, you know, in our milieu, in India. So I think there's a real, there is some universality that comes through to people, and there's a real hunger for stories that reflect the true Indian condition, like who we are now, what are our conflicts, and how are we trying to overcome them, and not trying to be like someone else. I'm just trying to be us. Maybe that's why it's translated in a big way, I think.
And also not confirming the perception of Indian, India, you know, there's a perception about India. So the film is not trying to, it's going beyond that.
Mm-hmm.
It's not trying to just confirm that perception.
Not really about India, it just is India.
No, like people had problem with Slumdog, Indian, you know, I had to, although I didn't agree with them, they said, you know, why India has to be seen in such a light, you know, India also is something else.
Mm-hmm.
But that was a story based, you know, that was a story based in that kind of situation. So you can't change the situation, and you know, it's filmmaking is not an image building exercise. You know,
right.
It's a story about that, you know, that conditions and
yeah.
Well, you've kind of become a universal actor. I think for people, there's a universality that's kind of built up around you now that you have, like, it seems you have a very significant career in India, and then you have a significant worldwide career, almost like they're separate a little bit, but it's, you've become a face for the country, and somebody people were comfortable with and used to, and...
Mm-hmm. I'm really fortunate, you know, I'm really fortunate. I don't know how, why it happened and how it happened. I'm just fortunate, I think. And I want to be fortunate all my life. You know, I keep getting different kind of opportunities. Sometimes it's a really challenge for me to, and I pick up stories in Hollywood which are much more challenging and which are, it's, for me it's more of a luxury. You know, I don't have to survive. Mm. You know, my survival doesn't depend on Hollywood. Most of the time, the kind of money I'm getting, I'm losing my money. You know, the kind of money I get in India. So I do it for just to challenge myself, just to expand my own experience and expand my craft.
So you weren't insulted at all when he thought of you as an older guy?
That was a really concern. And I suggested Guneet, and he was there. I said, why don't you ask Naseer Bhai? Naseer Bhai is an inspiration for
us. He's not really an older guy. It's a guy who feels old. So it was important not to cast an older guy in this. I think it was important to cast Irfan because, I mean, we didn't age him much. I mean, we aged him by 10 years, I think.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's a story of a guy who feels old because, you know, I mean, women love him in the movie and even otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
He has a huge family. I mean, the reactions I've seen, everyone's like, oh, I mean, especially from women. So. I don't think he plays an old man in the story. He just plays a person who feels old momentarily.
But in India, definitely, you know, I'll get a lot of offers where I have to, they'll say you can play your father or, you know, even like after life.
Screwed it up for you.
Yeah. No, I was aware of it. I was aware of it. And art cinema is different, you know, they are, there are no more role, you know, they don't write roles for elderly people. You know, the main, it's not like, you know, in Hollywood, a 50-year-old or 55-year-old is, you know, they are maturing. Mm-hmm. In India, we still need to hide our age and, you know, mm-hmm. we need to pose as a young boy and things like that. But, and also the other thing is, see, this
are
film
you
had...
Out? Are you really 75 years old and you're just hiding it really, really well?
Really, really, really well.
That's exactly. The death of the soul. Is
that, must be, that must be a great formula, you know. I can come out with a book and, you know, tell you how to pose as a young... So, the thing is, in India, we haven't found a way where we could just you know, the story is where we just depend on the story. It's more of to inspire people that, you know, you be like us. So the star plays that role. Mm-hmm. That see, I am something and you aspire to be me.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the role film plays in. Yeah.
But things are changing, you know, things
changing,
are changing.
Changing drastically.
Our movie getting a wide release in India is a good sign, and people are going to come and experience the story and, you know, experience the characters and look at them as real characters and not as, you know, Irfan or not as, as a star. So I think things will change.
And also the audience is inspiring the filmmakers. Audience is really, really hungry and eager to watch interesting cinema and original cinema.
Well, the intimacy, I mean, I think there's with all the big explosions and everything, that people miss the intimacy of that cinematic experience and feeling, you know, real people just being human and feeling. And it's kind of a lovely experience to go do that.
Yeah, I think really things will change because, you know, like what happened with the French New Wave hasn't happened since anywhere else in the world. A bunch of young directors came and really expressed themselves in a unique way, and they made really low-budget films that were very successful.
Mm-hmm.
And then more of those films started being made, and then we had the French New Wave. I think really the Indian audience will demand it, and people who don't and people who don't comply will become outdated. You know, we'll really start telling our stories.
So you're saying you want to keep your budgets low?
No, I didn't. I'm not saying that. I didn't say that. That part you can edit from.
Thank you guys so much. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Take care.